Father, we thank you for your presence in the service this morning. We thank you that, Lord, you're here again tonight to speak to us, to move in our hearts. And Lord, we just want to yield ourselves to you. We want to put everything else out of our minds right now and just focus on you. And Lord, we just pray that our hearts would be receptive, open to what you want to deposit there tonight. We just give you praise. We give you thanks for all that's going to be accomplished in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.
salvation's not just when we first get saved, amen? He's been saving us ever since, amen? Saving us for himself, helping us to become a little bit more like Jesus. Praise God for that. Thank you that though you are high and holy, God, you choose to dwell among your people. You inhabit the praises of your people. Hallelujah. We worship you tonight. We want to encounter you face to face. We want to be in the light of your glory, Lord Jesus, tonight. Hallelujah. We worship you. We give you praise. Hallelujah. your presence that we can sense in this room tonight. God, let that be what changes us, God, what shapes us, what molds us more into the people of God that you want us to be tonight. Your presence, hallelujah. Let it be what guides us, Jesus. Lord, let there be a hunger and a thirst in our hearts to never be outside of your presence, hallelujah, but to always be close to you. You said if we would draw near to you, that you would draw near to us. Lord, that's our heart's desire tonight, just to get a little closer to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Accept our worship as a sweet sound. God, I pray for your anointing upon the preaching of the word tonight. God, let there be chains that fall off. Let there be truth that's revealed. Let there be deeper depths that we go to because of what you would show us by your Holy Spirit tonight. We just thank you. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Let's go ahead and grab them this evening. We're going to continue with our study on Galatians chapter 6. This will be our second to last message, I believe, on this series. And it's been a good series. Brian worked hard this afternoon and got most of our go deeper Galatians Bible study from September to current on our podcast. And so if you've missed any of the Galatians study, be sure you go check that out. It's on our YouTube channel and our audio channel, but also on our podcast, which is sometimes a lot easier to access. And so make sure you make use of those, share that with others, those links with others. And the book of Galatians has shown us a lot of things that the modern church is dealing with today. And I don't know how anybody can spend any amount of sincere study of God's word in 2017 and not see that the Bible is relevant. Amen? It's still relevant. It's living and active, like Hebrews 4:12 says. And that's why every generation, this book is what needs to be the foundation of our faith. Amen? It's living, it's active, it's relevant. There's probably nothing more relevant, amen, than God's Word. And if we would pattern our lives after God's Word, instead of pulling scriptures here and there that we like to support or justify what we're doing, and most of the time we're taking the scripture out of context, I think our Christian faith would be a lot deeper. So let's believe the Lord to help us with that. Galatians 6, we're going to look at verses 9 through 11, and we'll read that from the Expositor Study Bible in just a moment. Listen to this story before we get started tonight. If the shoe fits, sell it. There were once two shoe salesmen who went to Africa to open new sales territories. 3 days after they arrived, the first salesman faxed a message. I will be returning on the next plane. I can't sell shoes here. Everyone goes barefoot all the time. There was no report from the second salesman for about 2 weeks. Then came a fat airmail envelope with this message for the home office. 50 orders enclosed. Prospects unlimited. Nobody here has shoes. Right? So it's all how we look at things. Most of the time, our perspective. And we're going to look tonight in these verses 9 through 11, at every opportunity to do good. And we can see things, sometimes our personalities do that to us, right? Where some of us are born with the personality that we always see the glass half empty. Some of us always see it half full. And those people you don't want to meet first thing in the morning, right? But in spite of our personalities, we can have the Holy Spirit help us to seize every opportunity to do good. And we're going to see some things tonight, I think, that will help us. Last week we talked about verses 7 and 8, a harvest of corruption or a harvest of everlasting life. It's up to us what we're going to receive. The seeds that we sow are the harvest that we'll reap. Amen? If we sow seeds to everlasting life, not just living forever, everyone's going to live forever. But the quality, the Zoe kind of life that God wants to give us, a quality of life now, we've got to sow the seeds for that to happen. And so we're going to continue on with verses 9 through 11 tonight. And I think there's some good things that the Lord wants to show us. So let's look at those verses. Galatians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. It says, "Let us not be weary in well-doing." Paul continues to speak of sowing to the Spirit. "For in due season we shall reap. In God's time, our faith in Christ and the cross will not go unrewarded, but will bring forth exactly that which is promised by the Lord, if we faint not. Many start the race but do not finish. They give up after a while, exclaiming that the cross doesn't work. Let all know and understand that we might fail, but the cross, in Jesus, of course, never fails. Verse 10, as we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men. The Holy Spirit will help us to do this, providing our faith is ever in the cross. Otherwise, we will fail, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. There are many who are of the faith, but really do not understand the faith, so they walk in defeat. We are to give them the message of the cross in order that they might walk in perpetual victory. Romans 8, 2. You see how large a letter I have written unto you with my own hand. This refers to the fact that Paul had written the entirety of the epistle to the Galatians himself, which he normally did not do. Scribes generally wrote as he dictated, with him writing the postscript and signing his name. So we're going to look at some things, four lessons tonight. I think the Lord wants to teach us concerning every opportunity to do good. Every opportunity to do good. So number one tonight, I think we can see in verse 9, the lesson we need to learn is let's not be weary in well-doing. Amen? Let's not be weary in well-doing. When we're trying to do something for God in our own strength, it's easy for us to grow weary, isn't it? But when we're empowered by the Holy Spirit, when our strength is depleted, God's strength takes over. Amen? In our weakness, Paul said, in my weakness, God's strength is made perfect. That's the sufficiency of God's grace, if we understand what His grace is really all about. It's not a license to keep on sinning. It's not a greasy grace that we can keep on living how we've always been living. Grace is the power of the Holy Spirit enabling us to be Christ-like, to grow and to mature, to not be baby Christians sucking our thumbs our whole life, but to be people that God can do miracles through. Amen? Not just coming to church, feed me, feed me, feed me. That's good. We need to be fed. But taking what we've received and then exercising our faith by telling others about Christ, laying hands on the sick and seeing them recover, doing the things that God called us to do, fulfilling the Great Commission. Amen? God wants us to mature. So let's not be weary in well-doing. Well-doing is what God calls good. Amen? That's well-doing. It's what God calls good. There's a lot of things that the modern church calls good, and that there may be nothing wrong with. Handing out water bottles, helping at the soup kitchen, people who are less fortunate. Those are things that we often call good. But are they really of eternal value? Sometimes they can be if the Holy Spirit is in it. And we're giving them Jesus while we're giving them a water bottle. We're giving them Jesus and telling them about the cross and the difference it can make in their life while we're serving them at the homeless shelter. Amen? But so much of what we call good and that we pat ourselves on the back for in the church, and that the world says, oh yeah, that's nice, that's what religious people ought to do, it's not necessarily what God calls good. And I think a lot of the times we're tired and we're worn out in our Christian walk because what we think we're doing that's good, what we call good, is not what God calls good. And we're busy, 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 lots of wheels in motion, but we're not doing what God wants us to do. Amen? And if we'll do what God wants us to do, He'll give us the grace, amen, the strength, the provision that we need to see it accomplished. And so we need to get His direction. God calls the preaching of the cross good. Amen? That's what God calls good. First and foremost. Good meaning wholesome, holy, a part of His character. So when you went to Cracker Barrel this afternoon and you ate lunch and you said, that chicken fried steak was good. No, it wasn't a part of God's character. It wasn't holy. It's not the same word that's used in the Bible. And I think that's where we miss it sometimes. We think it's good, like good, better, and best. And it's not. That's not what it's saying. It's saying a part of God's character. It's holy. It's wholesome. And God is saying that the preaching of the cross is good. That's what His heartbeat is. The heartbeat of Christ, our Savior, that brought Him to the cross to die in our place, is for the preaching of the cross, the preaching of God's redemption plan to humanity. He loves lost people. And we need to be involved in what He calls good. Souls being saved. That God calls good. Lives being delivered from addictions. You know what? God calls that good. It's inconvenient for us, isn't it? It's messy. when people need deliverance. If you've ever needed deliverance, you know what that's all about, right? No matter what it was. Maybe it wasn't alcoholism or drug addiction, but there were some other addictions in your life that God had to deliver you from. It's messy, but that's what God calls good. God calls sick bodies receiving healing. He calls that good. Amen. I want to see more of that in our services, in our church, not even just when we're in services. We're the church wherever we go, and God wants to bring healing to the members of His church, the body of Christ, us. And we want to see that. That's the good work that we ought to be involved in. Believers being baptized in the Holy Spirit. You know, the Lord considers that good. We ought to tell more people about the power of the Holy Spirit that's available to them. They don't have to keep a list of do's and don'ts in their own strength. The Holy Spirit will help you to be the person that God wants you to be. Do we tell people about that? The Lord calls that good, the moving and the operation of the Holy Spirit. I've been crying out as a pastor, God, would you let there be a moving of the gifts of the Spirit in our church? That it's not unusual for someone to give a message in tongues or interpretation, prophecy, a word of wisdom, word of knowledge. Yes, we've had some. Some of them are not limelight gifts. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge sometimes happens just in the altar, right? When you're praying with somebody, God tells you something about them you didn't even know and tells you to pray over them or sometimes to say something to them. But we need the gifts of the Spirit to be in operation because that's the good work that God wants to do here in Colorado Springs in the remnant, the body of Christ that He's raising up. So we ought to ask Him for that. Those things God calls good, and how often are we involved in the frivolous, the fleeting, the temporary things of this life, thinking that we're doing a good work for God and all we're really doing is wearing ourselves out. God, I want to be busy about the Master's business. I want to be preaching the gospel. I want to be telling as many as I can the message of the cross, because that will do a work in them even when I'm not there. Amen. When they're laying on their bed at night, if I give them what the Holy Spirit prompts me to give them, which is often a scripture, right? Then the Spirit of truth begins to deal with their hearts even when you're not there. They can't escape the message of the cross because the Holy Spirit is going to back it up and do what you cannot do. You can't save anybody. The Holy Spirit has to do the work in their hearts. Listen to this quote. It is the cooperation by the believer with the Spirit that accomplishes the task. He does not function in our hearts and lives as a slave master, but rather as a partner, John 16:7. The Holy Spirit wants to come alongside of you and help you, and you can see how He works, and you can be in cooperation with the Holy Spirit. So often we think, oh, this is a good idea, and the Holy Spirit's over here, and we're going this way, right? We're not in cooperation, or we're butting heads with the Holy Spirit. God's saying this is what He wants His Spirit to do in our church, in our community, and we think we have a different idea, and we're not working in cooperation with the Spirit. We're working against Him, and we don't even realize it sometimes. And what happens? You'll wear yourself out. But if you're flowing with how the Holy Spirit is flowing, getting into that river and finding out where the current of God is wanting to take us as a church, as a believer, then it's easy, right? It's like tubing down the river. You just get in and go, amen? You just get into the presence of God and you get work in cooperation with the Holy Spirit, and we can do what God calls good and see things happen in our lives, in our families, in our church, in our community that are just so much bigger than us. And it is a rest about it. Amen? It's not us wearing ourselves out. There's a rest in it. The word weary in the Greek is ekakeo, and it means to lose heart and to faint. The admonition is don't quit believing. Keep believing in Jesus and His performance, His work, His finished work at the cross. And we don't have to get on the works treadmill and say, I got to do 6 miles on the treadmill today, spiritual works treadmill. No, just rest. Holy Spirit, where are you wanting to take me today? I want to work in cooperation with you. How do you want to use me to witness to my neighbors, to that cashier at Walmart, or that teenager in the drive-thru at Burger King, whatever? How do you want to use me? God, I want to be sensitive to your Holy Spirit, and I want to do what you call good so I don't get worn out, so that I can be effective for you. So let's not be weary in well-doing. Number two, reaping a harvest comes in due season. Underline those words. In due season. A harvest is going to come. It doesn't matter what the devil tells you. It's a principle that God has put into place. We're going to reap what we sow. A harvest is coming. And as we said last week, it's either a harvest of corruption from our bad seeds, or it's a harvest of everlasting life because we've obeyed the word of God. And we've done what he's asked us to do. But there's a due season coming. Amen? There's a due season coming for some of us in this room tonight. We've been praying for something for a long time. There's a due season coming for Finished Work Worship Center. Amen? We're going to reap a harvest. God has not changed his mind about what he's called us to do. If we will do what he's called us to do, a harvest is coming in due season. Amen? And we need to believe the Lord. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. This due season is referring to a proper, specific, or suitable time. You know what? We don't get to decide what that proper, suitable, or specific time is. God does. When we're ready, he's going to begin to send us people who are broken, who are without Jesus in their lives, or in the process of dying. And he's going to say, here's your opportunity to minister Jesus to people. And we need to be ready for that suitable time, that harvest time that's coming. Seeds of the gospel, the message of the cross, have been planted consistently for more than 4 years in Colorado Springs, in the Pikes Peak region. And our due season is coming for this church. Amen? Amen. Our harvest of souls is coming. We need to believe God for it. Amen. There's a harvest of souls that needs to be won. You fill every church in this city. Think about it. I challenge you, think about that sometime. Go home and name all the big churches in town. Find out their seating capacity and do the math. We could fill every church to capacity in this city that currently exists with the buildings and the facilities they have, and there's still 300,000 to 400,000 people who would have no place to go. Now, nobody's packing all the churches, right? But even if everything was going so powerfully that every church was filled to capacity, there's still 300,000 to 400,000 people who'd have nowhere to go. So don't tell me there's not a harvest of unchurched, unsaved people that need Jesus. There's plenty of opportunity. As Jesus told the disciples, lift up your eyes. Don't say 4 months and then there's a harvest. Lift up your eyes and look, they're already white. The fields are white, they're ripe and ready for harvest. If we'll get our eyes off of our own circumstances, woe is me, which is what the devil wants us to be focused on, right? And we'll see the work, the good that God has called us to do. There is so much opportunity for the gospel. Amen? So much opportunity. We just need to allow the Holy Spirit, working in cooperation with him, to lead us into those opportunities. And we're going to see some powerful things happen. We've been planting seeds for 4 years. A bride for Christ is going to be perfected by the Lord's enabling, sanctifying grace through the preaching of the cross. It's not going to happen through the programs. We've had plenty of those in Colorado Springs. It's not going to happen just because of the simple fact that we have over 100 Christian ministries who have their headquarters in Colorado Springs. That's not changing the moral and spiritual climate of our city. It's been that way for a long time. That's nice to have those resources, but if they're not working, we need something more, don't we? We need the presence of God. We need the preaching of the cross, which brings the message, or brings the presence of God. And so we've got to see the enabling, sanctifying grace through the preaching of the cross and the power of the Holy Spirit. We ought to say, God, do it. These hurting, broken church people, like many of us were for too many years, God, heal the wounds. Let them see that there's a real, amen? That there's a real, and it's not about us, it's about Jesus. He's the real. And if we'll point them to Jesus and the cross, there's going to be a bride for Christ prepared. It's coming, so you better buckle your seatbelt and get ready. Amen? The Lord's getting ready to do something good. He's getting ready to do something good, and we're going to be a part of it. Not fainting or not losing heart. It is a picture of becoming exhausted as the result of giving in to evil. In the song, Though Satan Rages, We Will Not Be Defeated. We've got the power in the name of the Lord. Amen? We've got the power. When the devil lies to us, confront those lies with the truth of God's word, with the truth of who Jesus is and what he came to defeat. Satan understands the cross, doesn't he? He understands what happened at the crucifixion at Calvary. That's why he doesn't want the church to get a hold of it. He understands the utter defeat that happened at the cross. He would rather we be caught up in superficial religion and psychology and humanism than to understand the cross, because he understands it. He is defeated utterly and completely because of the cross. And so when he comes with his lies, though Satan rages, we need to tell him, no, you're not going to defeat me here, devil. Jesus already paid a price. It's not about me. You can talk about me all you want, accuse me before God all you want, but it's not about me. I'm hidden in Christ, and God's purposes are going to prevail in my life. God's purposes are going to prevail in my family. Amen? We have to have a fierce faith. I'm not going to have the object of my faith move from Jesus and the cross, no matter what you do, devil. You can touch my money. You can touch my health. You can mess with my church. You can mess with whatever. I'm still going to believe God. And we need to have that kind of fierce faith. We've got the power in the name of the Lord. Listen to this quote. Our faith in the cross will not go unrewarded, but will bring forth exactly that which is promised by the Lord. There's a harvest that God has promised. There's blessing that we talked about this morning that God has promised. All these blessings. Amen? Are you living in all those blessings that we talked about this morning? We want to, right? But I think some of us, you know, most of us are not in all those places. That's what God wants to pour into our lives. And if we'll trust Him, He's going to reward our proper faith. Number three, verse 10, let's do what God calls good as much as He gives us opportunity. I think it's Brother Larson who says quite a bit. He has some funny little quips that he says from Bible college, and then you hear him say it again like all these years later, and you're like, oh yeah, that was a good one. And I should write them down in my Bible. So a lot of the Bible college students did. But his quip was, you can't do what you can't do, right? His other one is, we're not human doings, we're human beings. I've liked that one too. But you can't do what you can't do. If God doesn't give you the opportunity, you can't do what God calls good, right? But how many know He is giving us an open door? He's giving us opportunities that we've never had before. And if He's giving us the opportunity, that means those whom He calls, He equips. Amen? We can do what God prepares for us to do, but we can't do what we can't do. He's not expecting us to do more than we're able to do, more than what He provides for. But if we understand the provision that He made for us in the cross, we'll see what a huge opportunity is in front of us. Amen? This church can have an impact on Colorado Springs and the Pikes Peak region and really the world through missions and world evangelism to where people are in heaven because of what happens at Finished Work Worship Center all over this world. And that's awesome. That's sobering. Amen? It ought to let us realize it's not just about us and playing church. It's a serious work that God wants to do, an opportunity that He's given us. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. As we have opportunity here, it speaks of the opportune time God gives us to do good things. And there's an opportune time. We talked about this last election, and though there's still political wrangling going on, there's media wrangling going on, God intervened in our country for a reason, and we need not soon forget that. We have a time of harvest extended, God's hand held back some pretty serious darkness, and we need to not forget that. We need to be doing everything that we can to get this gospel message out. Again, this has little or nothing to do with the temporary fleeting things that man calls good, and it has more to do with the eternal things that God calls good, like salvation, right? Like deliverance, like healing, like miracles, confirming His word, like Holy Spirit baptisms, calls to ministry, the gifts of the Holy Spirit in operation. Those are the things that God calls good. And there's opportunity for all of those things in this church, in our community, as we just believe God and continue to follow hard after Him. Amen? He wants to do some good things, and He wants to include us. Why He includes us when we're such a mess, even as believers? There's none who does good, like we talked about this morning, but He still chooses to use us. He's patient, isn't He? He's a patient Father. And we make a lot of mistakes, But he wants us to be involved, and we're going to see Jesus receive the glory for all that's accomplished if we'll cooperate with the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 through 17, talking about seizing every opportunity that God has placed in front of us to do what he calls good. Think about that as we read these verses. Ephesians 5, verses 15 through 17. See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time. Some translations say making the most of every opportunity, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. What's made clear in Scripture that the will of the Lord is? 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not willing that what? Any should perish. God wants people to be saved. He wants people to know the message of the cross. He wants his church to preach the cross. That's clear from Scripture. So you may not know any other specific details about personal things in your life and what the will of God is, but his will is made clear as far as the gospel is concerned. And we need to be wise in spreading it every opportunity that we have. Amen? Amen. Every conversation that we can point people to Jesus and his finished work. Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. This is talking about those outside of the covenant love relationship with Jesus Christ. How we act toward lost people. Do we have a heart that aches because they're in the process of dying without Jesus in their life? Or are we apathetic and complacent and indifferent? And as long as I'm saved, I'm good. God weeps. He grieves for the lost, for sinners. It says he would leave 99 who are already saved and living for him to pursue the one. Would we? Would we do the same? If we're Christ-like, we will. And if we're not there, we need to say, God, change my heart, soften my heart. Not just for my loved ones, but for every person that's lost. And Lord, help me to redeem the time. Help me to make the most of every opportunity. We grow in our relationship with the Lord as our faith stays anchored in the cross, with the Holy Spirit ever drawing us closer to Christ and keeping close company with others who also hear and respond to what God says. That's why you come to church, I hope, is to be around people who want what Jesus wants. Amen. To find out what Jesus wants, and then to want it together, collectively, as a group, and go after it. That's what God's purpose is for the church. Finished Work Worship Center has incredible opportunities in front of us. We have an opportune time to engage in what God calls good, and he's just beginning to unfold some things for us as a church. Amen. It's exciting. It's exciting. We prayed at the beginning of the year the prayer of Jabez, remember? 1 Chronicles 4:10. Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory. He's done it, hasn't he? Didn't think it was going to happen that quick, but he's doing it. And again, I'm not just talking about a building. Amen. I'm talking about the opportunities that are going to come because of how he's blessing us. Amen. I'm talking more about the spiritual things that are going to be moving and happening. And we need to believe him. We prayed it. He's answered it. That you would keep me from evil, that I might not cause pain. We need to cause blessing by pointing people to the blesser, to Jesus. We need to keep praying that prayer of Jabez, and God use us. We've also been standing on God's promises in Joshua 1:3. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, as I said to Moses. Those promised blessings, those treasures that he's promised to those with proper faith. Everywhere the sole of our feet go, God goes with us. Amen. We are the church, the ecclesia, everywhere we go. We're not just the church when we're at 2380 Montebello Drive. We're not just the church in our new facility at 2976 North Academy. You're the church wherever you go, because Christ lives in you. You're a temple of the Holy Spirit. And when we wake up to that, we're going to see there are huge opportunities for us to do what God calls good. And then just bring those people to church with you. Yeah, fill the building too. That's good. But you're the church wherever you go. God wants us to get a hold of that. So let's take the land that God has promised us. Let's step out into the opportunities to declare the message of the cross to more people. in Colorado Springs, in the Pikes Peak region, and let's make the most of every opportunity that God brings our way. Our due season is upon us, isn't it? The opportunity to do good is upon us. And if it's there, God's going to equip us. If we'll depend upon Him, He's going to equip us to make a difference. Number four, verse 11. Paul was adamant with the Galatians about doing what God calls good. Here, again, remember what the setting is of the book of Galatians. We've been talking about a lot of application for us. But these Judaizers, these religious people, had come in and tried to add to the gospel. Jesus plus circumcision equals holier living. And Paul is saying, no, no, no. It's only Jesus and what He did at the cross. Don't go back to the old law. Remember, that's the setting of this whole book. And we see how serious Paul is telling the Galatians, God's people, that he won to the Lord out of paganism, out of false gods and idolatry, never even known God before that. He's so adamant about them understanding what it means to do what God calls good that he pens the entire book of Galatians himself. And normally he dictated the epistles that are in the New Testament. He was that adamant. He couldn't, whether that means he couldn't wait for a scribe because this was that important, or what that means, you can see this is a serious message, and it's a serious message for the modern church. We got to stop trying to add to the work that Jesus did on the cross. There's nothing we can add. The blood was enough, amen? Calvary was enough. And if we'll just rest in Jesus and the cross, we have everything that we need for life and godliness. Verse 11, Paul says, "See with what large letters I have written to you with my own hand." Some say he may have had an eye problem, which I don't know. They can argue, I don't know. Maybe that was. Or some say he was writing like, you know, when you type social media clue number one, when you're on Facebook, if you type in all caps, it's like you're screaming. Did you know that? You're not supposed to put it in all caps unless you mean it to be in all caps. And some are saying that Paul was saying he wrote the whole letter in all caps. I don't know if that's true either. But he was adamant, no matter what you believe about that verse, of making sure the Galatians understood how serious a matter it is to be doing what God calls good. God didn't call going back into the law good. He's saying to the modern church today, all these gimmicks and games that are coming through the modern church that are 40 days of this, 7 habits of that, 21 steps of this, He doesn't call that good. Amen? He doesn't call that good. He calls that which is of His Spirit. He calls what Jesus, His Son, did at the cross good. And we better understand the importance of that. Paul usually dictated his messages, but what was going on with the Judaizers and their false teaching among Galatians had to be dealt with immediately. So Paul wrote the entire epistle to the Galatians himself, most scholars believe. You cannot do what God calls good if you're entangled in false teaching, false preaching, another Jesus, another gospel that's all motivated by another spirit. Again, like we said earlier, if you're butting heads with the Holy Spirit, you're wearing yourself out and nothing's being accomplished that God calls good. Get away from that mess, Paul was telling the Galatians. God's saying to the modern church, get away from that mess. Get back to the cross. Get back to the Bible. Paul said it to the Galatians. God's saying it to us today. Get away from that mess. Start doing what God calls good, which is found only by way of the cross of Jesus Christ, no other way. The message preached from FWWC, from our church, it may not be heard from any other pulpit in Colorado Springs, right? I've been to some churches. I've been on staff in some other churches. We may have a unique message, but so what? If it's what God calls good, it's what we need to preach. Amen? It's what we need to preach. It's the only message that will bring eternal change for the better in people's lives. It doesn't matter. I don't care if anybody ever copies us, what we do. It's not about cookie-cuttering what we're doing, right? It's about doing what God calls good. And if we're doing what God calls good, whatever results is just extra. Amen? It's just extra blessing. We want to preach what He's called us to preach. And that's the message of the cross. That's going to bring eternal change in people's lives. It's going to bring a harvest of souls. And as we said, it's going to raise up a bride for Christ that's without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. And that's going to be worth it all. Amen. On that day when we stand before Him, to know that we were involved, it wasn't really our work. We just participated and cooperated. Amen. Jesus did the work, and He chose to involve us in it. And so let's not miss those opportunities. Every opportunity that God has given us to do good, what He calls good, let's be involved in it. Amen. Let's be His hands extended this week. Would you stand with me tonight? Praise the Lord. Many may be listening through our social media, YouTube, audio channels, and maybe you're listening tonight. You'd say, Pastor Eric, I'm not sure I'm saved. I'm not sure that I'm ready for heaven tonight if Jesus were to come back, and I want to be. I don't want to keep doing things that are not pleasing to God, but sin is ruling my life. There's things I just can't quit doing in my own strength. Every one of us in this room has been there and had to ask Jesus for help. So I want us to pray this prayer tonight. And if you've never given your heart to the Lord and you need to surrender to Him tonight, there's no better time than the present. Amen. Now is the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation, the Bible says. And stop playing games with sin. Sin is deadly. It will kill you spiritually. And surrender those things to the Lord, and He wants to help you. So would you pray this prayer after me? Let's let the Lord touch you. If you need to rededicate your heart to the Lord, you knew Him at one time, but you've gotten away from Him. Pray this prayer in faith, and I believe the Lord will help you. He'll cleanse you. He'll give you a fresh start again tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to You in Jesus' name, admitting and acknowledging that I am a sinner. I believe, Jesus, that You died on the cross for my sins, paying the penalty that I deserved. And I am in need of You, Jesus, to be my Savior, to be my Lord. Please forgive me for all my sin. Wash me, make me clean, and help me from this day forward to live for You. Thank You for saving me, making me ready for heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want us to close with this song tonight. Let Your glory fall in this room. Can we sing that with sincere hearts? And I want us to find a place to pray if you can. If you want to kneel, you can. If you want to come up to this front row and make it an altar of prayer. An altar is a place of death to self. And what you leave at the altar, you shouldn't get up with. Amen. Maybe there's some things that you need to lay down. Maybe it's not sin, it's just weights. Maybe there's circumstances that are weighing you down, burdens that the enemy is trying to put on you. Church is a place where we can lay our burdens down, amen? Calvary is a place, which is what the altar represents, where we can lay our burdens down. And when we get up from that altar of prayer, we ought to be different, amen? God wants to give us a lighter load. He wants to give us help and encouragement and strength. So I want us to take a few moments while I'm singing this song tonight, and let's find a place to pray. Let's ask the Lord to help us to not become weary in the incredible, opportune time that's in front of us. Amen? Individually. God, I don't want to grow faint. I don't want to get weary. Help us as a church as we make it through this transition time into our new building. God, help us not to get weary, to get short with each other, to get silly battles over things that really don't matter when the trumpet sounds, but God, give us a strength to move forward into the due season that You have for our church, amen? And together to take all the land that He wants for us to take in Colorado Springs. And let's ask Him to help us take Jesus Christ and the cross to as many as we can, as quickly as we can, to receive the harvest that He says will come. There will be a harvest. Let's pray for that. Let's pray that there will be a remnant raised up. Broken, lost, hurting people brought back to Jesus. A bride prepared for Christ. Let's pray for all those things tonight. Can we take a few moments and do that as I sing this song? And let's find an altar of prayer. Let's let the Lord work in our individual lives and pray for our church as well.
Father of creation, unfold.
Cry, God, let your glory fall in my heart, in my life, in my family, in my church, amen, in our community. And let's believe the Lord to do something powerful. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, tonight for your word. We thank you for what you're speaking to our hearts through the book of Galatians. God, you want a response from each one of us. God, I pray that we'll give you the response that you desire, God, from our lives. Each one of us may be in a different place spiritually, so our response may look a little different. But God, we want to walk in obedience. Lord, we want to please you with how we respond to your word tonight. God, help us to see what you call good. Help us to discover what you call good. And help us to discern, Lord, the things that are just a waste of time, the things that are just temporary and fleeting and of this world. And God, help us to be sowing seeds to have an everlasting harvest, Lord Jesus. Lord, we don't want to be in the frivolous. We don't want to be in the fleeting. God, we want to be doing what you call good. Help us to recognize those opportunities that you're putting in front of us individually and as families and as a church. God, help us to be working in cooperation with the Holy Spirit to see a good work done here in Colorado Springs in the Pikes Peak region. Lord, we want Finished Work Worship Center to be doing the Master's business, what you call good, preaching the message of the cross, seeing souls saved, seeing hearts delivered, seeing people baptized in the Holy Spirit and set free, used of you in the gifts of the Spirit, called into ministry. So God, help us to be focused on those results of faith in the cross. Lord, we just believe you for good things. Help us to recognize the due season that's in front of us. Lord, there's going to be a harvest. There's going to be blessings. God, help us not to forget the blesser in the midst of those blessings, to keep looking for your direction, to keep listening for your voice. God, there's too many people that need Jesus in this community. There's still so much work that needs to be done. God, equip us for that work. Help us to bring in a harvest of souls. Help us to prepare a bride for your return, a church, a remnant that you're coming back for. Lord, we just believe you for that. Lord, even this week, help us to seize the divine appointments that you bring our way. Give us boldness, God, to declare your goodness to everyone that we come in contact with. God, help us to have an opportunity to lead them to Christ, to lead them to salvation. Lord, we just thank you for that. Bless us as we leave this place tonight. Lord, you see each heart. You know each need that's represented by those standing here tonight. And God, I pray that you'll prove the enemy a liar and the accuser of the brethren, that you'll bring breakthrough, that you'll bring healing, God, that you'll bring all the blessings that Jesus paid for at the cross, that we'll be living in them every day, God, not doubting, not questioning whether it's really true, but God, seeing a breakthrough, seeing answers to prayer. Minister to those needs that are represented by your people here tonight. And God, we'll just be quick to give you the praise, to give you the glory and the honor for all that's accomplished. Give us a good week. Keep us close to you throughout this week, we pray. In Jesus' name, hallelujah.